All right, Tom, last speaker, and then everybody can, of course, ask questions. Talk to us, if you will, about another big issue, or maybe a big issue, Governor's criminal justice reform legislation and the implications on the public's right to know.
Sure, absolutely. So essentially we are in the fifth year of the Governor's criminal justice reform programs. Over the last 5 years, he's introduced legislation that has dramatically changed the way the state of Georgia incarcerates criminals, the terms that apply, and really the effort, and it's been a very successful effort, has been to try and reduce the size of Georgia's prison population and to try and make the prison system a little fairer and more effective at reintroducing offenders back into society. It's been a terrific success. It's been an example to the nation at the federal level. They're looking at Georgia and really holding it out as something that's performed very well. And so Governor Deal and the Criminal Justice Reform Council deserves a lot of credit for that. But there is one aspect of their program that has a great deal of friction with First Amendment interests. And this year, they are saying that they will be dropping new legislation. They have not dropped it yet, but it's expected, I would expect it within the next 10 to 15 days. That the contents of that legislation they haven't disclosed, but they have suggested, and we'll have to wait and see, that one aspect of it may be trying to change the existing First Offender Act in the state of Georgia. The First Offender Act is a law that has existed in our state for some time, and it's an unusual law. It allows somebody who's before the criminal justice system on their first offense to enter a very unusual plea. In that plea, you plead under the First Offender Act, and you are placed on probation before there is an adjudication of guilt. And if you successfully complete that probation, then the criminal charges against you are discharged. What does that mean? That means you are in a position at the end of that probationary period to say, I have never been convicted of a crime. There will be no record that you were convicted of a crime. You can answer inquiries saying, I was never convicted of a crime. And so that the First Offender Act goal is basically to try and help people who are in front of the criminal justice system for the first time to make sure that they don't end up with something that permanently damages their record, a very worthwhile goal. The friction is this. There is a concern by the Criminal Justice Reform Council that notwithstanding the First Offender Act, the fact that people have been arrested, the fact that they have a criminal case file in court, is creating an impediment to their getting jobs. And so there is at least discussion that the First Offender Act should be changed so that as soon as you plead, you enter a First Offender Act plea, your case would be sealed, and your case would be sealed at the GCIC level, in other words, the database of arrest and conviction information. It would be sealed in the courtroom. It would be sealed at the courthouse itself. And that is a dramatic change from the way the law works right now. Currently, while you're on probation, your criminal case file will remain open to the public. The public can be at the case proceedings. The public can pull up your case file. And the media can as well. If this is the legislation they are proposing, it would mean as soon as you enter that plea, your case would disappear. It would disappear from the criminal justice system. And so, it is possible the legislation they propose will not be that radical, but we have to wait and see. And so this is really an effort to try and alert people to something that may be coming. So let me just give you an example to explain sort of worst case, what are the implications of this situation in terms of access to our court system and our court records. Here's two examples. Let's say your child is injured in an assault. whether it's at school, whether it's at some public event, you want to go check on how, and the individual who assaulted him is arrested. You want to go check on how that case is proceeding. If a First Offender Act plea were allowed to be entered immediately and immediately sealed the record, when you went to the court to try and find out how that criminal case was proceeding, you would no longer be able to see the court file. The court system would say, we have no case on that. And so as soon as that person entered a First Offender Act plea, that essentially the criminal case file and all records of that criminal case would no longer be available. Give you another example from the media perspective. A candidate for city council for some public office, you're hearing from a source that he had a DUI. You want to go look at the circumstances of that DUI. You go to the courthouse, you ask for the case file, you're told we have no case under that name. And if that council person or candidate had entered a plea under the First Offender Act, and if it's immediately sealed and sealed at all levels, the court system would not disclose that a case exists, and the court system would not allow you to see the case file, even if that's the candidate is still in their probationary period.
Wouldn't the plea still be public record?
Essentially what the Criminal Justice Reform Council has done in the way they've been changing the law, and this occurred in 2014 in some other areas, but I think we should be focused on the legislation this year for exactly that reason, is they are also sealing law enforcement records. So when they are now the sealing program that takes place, and frequently they call it expungement, but it's essentially a sealing system. Not only are the court records sealed, but all the records at the law enforcement agency are simultaneously sealed. And so it is essentially a significant effort to erase completely the criminal history with respect to some offenses. And a lot of the focus so far has been arrests that haven't resulted in a conviction. If they move into the First Offender Act, we're going to start seeing that same system moved into arrests that resulted in a plea. A plea entered the First Offender Act in which you're really not denying liability. It's possible that this, when the legislation gets submitted, will only apply to minor nonviolent crimes. That would be a significant positive step.
How would the law written now? Is it felonies, misdemeanors?
It can apply to all levels except the seven deadly sins. Except for the most extreme crimes, you can enter a First Offender Act plea currently, but you would be put on a probation period. The more serious the crime, your probation is going to be longer, and the record of that case will be public. So. I put it out there mostly as it's something that we all need to watch, because it will potentially be a significant step to close records both at the law enforcement level and at the court system.
Go ahead, sir.
Tom or Lori, do you sense that the First Amendment is under an even more dastardly or scurrilous attack? Does Donald Trump, for example, his assault on the news media, is that the tipping point of where we're going?
I think there's sort of two challenges that are facing the First Amendment and news reporting generally right now. Is one, I think there is where I think there's an ebb and flow in terms of respect for the media, and I do think we're at a point where there's a fair amount of hostility right now. But another part that I think is a very powerful influence that erodes First Amendment rights, particularly at the Georgia General Assembly, it kind of feeds into exactly what Peter's talking about, is very broad concerns right now about personal privacy. And one of the things we face over and over again in trying to monitor legislation at the General Assembly is erosion of the Open Records Act based on legislators basically trying to tap into the public's concern about their personal information, about that there is a great deal of public concern that their identity is going to be stolen, that their personal information is being used in ways they don't anticipate. A lot of that, frankly, takes place at the commercial level, not with government records. But legislatures are increasingly adding exceptions to the Open Records Act to restrict access to government records that are really very helpful at revealing what government does on a daily basis, under the guise of saying, well, we're trying to protect personal privacy. We're trying to make sure the citizen's personal information is not lost. So, and very frequently, what will protect citizens' information is the routine part of Open Records Act, is where things get redacted. No government records are released intentionally in the state of Georgia that have private personal information about citizens. That information is redacted by the agencies before it's released. So we don't need to create new exceptions.
But, Secretary of State's
office. Right. But over and over again, they're creating new exceptions for that situation. And Lori brings up a very good example of what occurred over the recently. There was a disclosure by the Secretary of State's office of database information that unfortunately did, where the personal information had not been redacted from us. The Attorney General's Attorney General Owens is here, and he can explain the circumstances perhaps more, but as I understand it, the Secretary of State's office quickly recovered all copies of that information that was disclosed. In other words, all copies that had been released were quickly recovered by the Secretary of State, and so there really was no disclosure of personal privacy in that, of any personally private information in that situation. But it does, it created quite a level of concern. And so that is something legislators respond to. So we're constantly fighting a battle to try and make sure access to public information is not lost based on fears about personal privacy.
And I'll just add, I kind of chuckled when I first heard it, but some of these college kids on college campuses who are saying they want to do away with the First Amendment, I laughed, of course, and then I thought, oh my gosh, like, they're serious. What are they teaching in these colleges? And, you know, why would kids even think about that? And, you know, what I want to say is, hey, have you ever reported in China? Have you ever been to Cuba? Go see how important the First Amendment is. So I think we need to do something at the college level, too, to really reiterate to kids that it's the First Amendment. It's first for a reason.
Well, I think we should go a little deeper to high school.
Yes.
Before they get to that.
Yes.
Other question, Nydia, go ahead.
Good morning, I'm Nydia Tisdale. What public notice is required to ban video recording in either a public or a private place?
Do you
notice? Sure, who wants to jump in?
We have no idea why you would want to know this.
I really am racking my brain to figure out why.
So, just broadly, in terms of banning videotaping in a private place, that is up to the owner of the private location. And so if it's not a public meeting, if it's not a meeting subject to the Open Meetings Act, then the owner of the private facility is going to have the discretion to permit or not permit videotaping. Public, any meeting that's subject to the Open Meetings Act is required, they are required to permit audio or videotaping. And so, as you know well, and Nydia's been involved in litigation, the Attorney General very successfully represented her in connection with that litigation. You are permitted to videotape in an open meeting subject to the Open Meetings Act, and excluding you is a violation of the Open Meetings Act, and in Ms. Tisdale's case, resulted in fine and attorney's fees being entered against the city of Cumming in connection with that.
Jerry, is there ever an argument, though, that maybe some private forums still can be open to the public, become matter places of public accommodation? Does that change it at all?
Yeah, and a lot of times, I mean, in Nydia's case in particular, some media outlets were allowed to film and others were not. There was no ban.
But in terms of notice, I don't know that the law requires any particular notice. It's not supposed to happen. They're not supposed to, if it's an open meeting ban.
I guess if it's advertised as an open to the public meeting and they select one individual and ban that person from video recording, what type of notice is required? It's sort of a hybrid situation.
It's also a pooling thing, like, right? Because in judicial
proceedings, it's very confusing.
They can do that and they have to share it. And so I don't know if there's any law specifically that relates to that.